This episode is brought to you by Experian. Are you paying for subscriptions you don't use, but can't find the time or energy to cancel them? Experian could cancel unwanted subscriptions for you, saving you an average of $270 per year and plenty of time. Download the Experian app. Results will vary. Not all subscriptions are eligible. Savings are not guaranteed. Paid membership with connected payment account required.
This is Monday Matinee on the Mutual Audio Network. Come on, let's all go to the lobby. Because people are staring at us listening to these shows while we're in the theater.
The following audio drama is rated G for general audiences.
How do I... I'll skip ahead a bit. No, I can't skip ahead. All right, everybody, into the time machine.
No. You don't understand how radio works. All I have to do to return this is fade my voice out like this and cue the organist. And you see, here we are.
Wait a minute.
63 Audio presents the Old Time Radio Essentials Podcast.
Greetings all who gather here and welcome to Old Time Radio Essentials. If this is your first time joining us, and even if it ain't, I must inform you that this is episode 22. My name is Pete.
This is Dave.
And I'm Paul.
The purpose of our show is to present specific episodes of our favorite Old Time Radio series, episodes that stand out as particularly representative of those series or as one of those quotable episodes that fans of old radio like to discuss, either in person or on social media.
We'll open each episode by introducing the selection, describing it briefly, and then we'll play it for you. Then we'll come back at the end and discuss it at length, each of us giving their opinions on its merit, its performances, or anything that stands out for us.
And that's exactly what we're presenting to you. Just our opinions on whether or not it's worthy of a place in every old-time radio aficionado's personal collection. You don't have to agree with us. In fact, we may not agree with each other. But we do hope you'll enjoy what we bring to the table and come back for more.
Each of us three will take turns selecting a show for discussion. Last month, we had as our guests the gang from the Mysterious Old Radio Listening Society, and their selection was a radio primer from the Columbia Workshop, in case you missed it. This month, it's finally back to Paul for his choice. So what do you have for us, Paul?
Well, I figured what with St. Paddy's Day coming quickly, and we're still dealing with COVID... Duffy's Tavern, something a little on the Irish side. And this episode was from 1945, March 16th. And to keep it a little bit more Irish, they even have a guest star of Pat O'Brien. Seán bigorra.
Duffy's Tavern was an American radio situation comedy that ran for a decade on several networks. CBS from 1941 to 1942, NBC Blue Network from 1942 to 44. And NBC from 1944 to 51, concluding with the December 28, 1951 broadcast.
And so, in honor of St. Paddy's Day, we present guest star Pat O'Brien for March 16, 1945, and Duffy's Tavern.
And now, friends, adjust your radio dials to the proper frequency. Get comfortable and listen.
Again this week, during the Danny Kaye absence, we present another great comedy cast. Tonight,
we take you now to Duffy's Tavern.
Hello, Duffy's Tavern. Where do you eat meat, eat Archie, the man you're speaking? Duffy ain't here. Oh, hello, Duffy. Big crowd here tonight. Oh, yeah, Three Drink O'Reilly, Foulmouth Flaherty. Yeah, and that quiet-talking Irish guy, Pat O'Brien. Yeah, the Irish Hush. Yeah, you seen him in the movies, Duffy, you know, real He-Man. Broad-shouldered, rugged, and powerful, and yet with that certain something about him that the other guy always gets the dame. Yeah. Hey, what time you coming down, Duffy? Well, tonight is the big dinner. Your 33rd wedding anniversary. You forgot about it. Your memory's getting shorter since Mrs. Duffy's been beating you over the head with that baseball bat. Well, you better not let her know you forgot this one, or instead of a short memory, you'll wind up with a tall memorial. I'll call you back.
Tavern, where we find Clifton Finnegan, Miss Duffy, Eddie the waiter, Clancy the cop, Matty Melnick and his orchestra, our guest star tonight, Pat O'Brien, and Archie himself, Ed Gardner.
Okay, Eddie, we got to get ready for the Duffy's party now. Let's lift this sandbag on top of this beer keg here.
Right.
Good. Now, we add to it this 300-pound sack of flour. Let's see, altogether, it's 400 pounds. Ready? Lift.
Woo! That ain't no use, Mr. Archer. That beer keg just won't hold 400 pounds.
Where is Mrs. Duffy gonna sit?
Yes, sir. You know, that Mrs. Duffy is always a big seating problem.
And every year, the problem gets bigger. What a big behemoth. I wonder what she does weigh.
Just a second, Archie. Maybe Mama is a little heavy, but she's built in perfect proportion.
Look what rode in on a broom here. Miss Duffy, your mother has perfect proportion?
Certainly. She has fat hips and fat legs, but don't forget that's balanced by the fact that she has a very fat face.
Oh.
Eddie, do you think my mother looks so very fat?
Well, Miss Duffy, I'm in no position to say.
What do you mean in no position to say?
Well, if I say it, I won't have no position.
Look, will you stop about your mother, Miss Duffy? You can't make a zephyr out of a heifer. Holy cat, the 33rd anniversary. You know, it's hard to believe that with so many people in the world that them two married each other.
Now, Just a second, Archie. It was true love from the day they first met in Ireland.
Oh, they met in Ireland? I never knew that.
Yeah, at Blarney Castle.
Blarney Castle, huh?
Yeah. Papa and some friends had gone to visit the castle, and that's where the whole thing started.
Yeah, huh?
Yeah. Papa thought he was kissing the Blarney Stone, and it turned out to be Mama.
How quaint. Well, look, Eddie, we better get busy with the anniversary party. Did that new chef finish the cake yet?
Yeah, he finished it.
Well, how is it?
Well, it started... I started... Oh, hey, that gives me an idea.
What?
That's what Mrs. Duffy can sit on.
On the anniversary cake? Well, it's an idea, but first maybe we better blow out the candles, huh? Now, come on, let's get busy. We still got a lot of loose ends here.
What?
Well, hello, Finnegan. Welcome to the party. What did you do, come stag?
No, I walked.
Finnegan, stag means a guy that ain't got a girl.
The stag's a guy that ain't got a girl?
Well, you know, it's a figment of speech. Real stag looks like that moose head over there.
No wonder he ain't got a girl.
Oh, forget it. What do you got under your arm there?
Oh, that's an anniversary present for Duffy.
Oh, and did you bring one for Mrs. Duffy?
Why, is it her anniversary, too?
Well, naturally.
Boy, she horns in on everything.
Hey, Arch, look, will you take a look at this present I bought? I want to ask you something about it.
Okay, let's see it. Nice present. Why'd you want to ask me about it?
What is it?
Why, it's obvious. Don't you know what it is?
No.
Well, then why did you buy it?
The man said you couldn't get him no more.
Well, that's very interesting. Eddie, look, did you ever see one of these?
Sure. That's a waffle iron.
Hey, you see, Finnegan, it's a waffle iron. Maybe after this you'll take my word for things.
Well, good evening, boys.
Well, hello, Officer Clancy. Glad to see you. Have a little something to heighten the color of your nose?
Don't mind if I do. Say, what's that?
Oh, that's Duffy's anniversary present, Clancy. It's a thing you iron waffles with.
Clancy, did you get the Duffys a present?
Naturally. After all, I was at their wedding.
Yeah, that's right, Clancy. You was there when the battle started, wasn't you? Tell me, how did Duffy act? I'll bet he was scared, huh?
No, as I remember, he was quite brave. Took it like a man. Except for one tense moment when it looked like he was going to break and run.
When was that?
When he heard the words, "You may kiss the bride."
Hello? Oh, hello, Duffy. Hey, we're waiting for you. What's keeping you? You fighting with Mrs. Duffy? About what? Oh, she found out you forgot about the anniversary and she's letting you have it, huh? What's she hitting you with? Everything but the... Hello?
What was that?
The kitchen sink. Sounds like Mrs. Duffy is rather provoked.
Well, hello, hello, hello. As Gene Autry said to a pair of his pants, how are you, chaps?
Well, well, well. Our old pal, Sir Heathcliff, the comedian. I thought I told you to stay out of here.
As the cow said to the milkmaid, I didn't expect such a cold hand.
Well, wait a minute, Heathcliff. Tonight is Duffy's anniversary party. Do you know any Irish jokes?
Irish jokes? Of course, old boy. As the dog said when he walked out of the flea circus, I've got a million of them.
Mm-hmm.
Just listen to this one. It seems there were two Irishmen, Pat and Mike. Pat said to Mike, Mike, my sister is marrying a fine Irish lad. So Mike said, oh, really? And Pat said, no, O'Reilly.
Tonight the corn is green. Heathcliff, why don't you get a partner called Abner so you can do an act called Crumb and Abner? Oh, really know O'Reilly.
Mr. Archie, Mr. O'Brien's on his way in.
Oh, good. Fellas, come on. Pat's here. Finnegan, Clancy, leave us give him some real Irish atmosphere,
okay.
Huh?
Tora, Laura, Laura. Tora, Laura, Laura. Tora, Laura, Laura. That's my wild Irish roll.
Finnegan.
Hey, hey, what goes on here?
Oh, it's just a little welcome for you, Pat. Fellas, look, it's Pat O'Brien. Well, well, Pat, the top of the mavornin' to you.
Thank you, and the back of Makushla to you.
Well, I'm glad you finally got here, me fair spalpeen. You, ain't been down here, to the tavern in quite a while. How come?
Let's call it the luck of the Irish.
Pat, that is no way for an Irishman to talk. After all, don't forget, you're one of Duffy's own lancemen.
Yes. By the way, where is Duffy?
He's home.
He's smart.
Now, wait a minute, O'Brien. The way you wrap this joint, I'm wondering if you're an Irishman at that.
How would you like a healthy punch in the nose?
Don't evade the question. Are you sure you're Irish?
Yes, I'm Irish.
Then why wasn't you in Going My Way?
Archie, what kind of talk is this? Accusing an O'Brien of not being an Irishman.
Thank you, officer.
Why, I've never seen a finer figure of an Irishman.
That's very nice of you, officer.
Sure, me and the wife has admired you for these many years.
Thank you, officer.
How's chances of getting me in pictures?
You in pictures, Clancy?
And why not? They always have them parts in pictures, them thick-headed cops. Why should they hire actors when in a man like me they can get the real thing?
No, that would be carrying reality too far.
Where's me club? Archie, explain that remark.
Now, Clancy, I merely meant that you would be perfect as a thick-headed cop.
Oh, well, that's different.
Your apology is accepted.
Oh, it's Mr. O'Brien.
Yeah? Archie, where do these things come from? Out of the woodwork?
Well, sometimes. Other times, we just drop them from the chandelier.
That's right. By the way, Mr. O'Brien, that Margaret O'Brien, is that your wife?
Pennington. Margaret O'Brien, she's only 7 years old.
Yeah, they said the same thing about Shirley Temple, and what did she turn out to be, a married woman?
You got a point there.
Hello, Mr. O'Brien. I'm Miss Duffy, my parents' attractive daughter.
Brother, this joint is a nest of them.
Mr. Archie, the phone?
Yeah, okay, I'll be right with you, Pat. Hello? Oh, hello, Mrs. Duffy. No, he didn't come down here. What's the matter? You sound scared. He did? Well, I'll see if I can find him. Oh, sure. Well, keep a stiff upper chin. Hey, Eddie, Duffy has disappeared. Mrs. Duffy says he threatened to go out and kill himself.
Now, I don't believe it.
Why?
Why should he go out to kill himself when Mrs. Duffy could render him the same service at home?
Well, you never can tell about that guy. I better see if I can find him. Let's see. I'll call his lodge. Hello? County Cork Culture Club? Is Duffy there? A bald guy. No, huh?
Maybe he was blackballed.
Will you cut out the crummy jokes, Heathcliff? Let's see. Where else could he be? Hello? O'Rourke's Turkish Baths? Is Duffy there? He ain't? Well, this is Archie. I'm trying to find him. Who's this? Oh, hello, Abdo. Huh? Yeah, I know, but I'll be in. Well, you know, I've been kind of busy lately. Huh? Oh, no, I ain't taking no bets no place else. Yeah, I'll be in. Okay. Nice guy, that Abdul O'Rourke. Now, where could that Duffy have gone to?
Say, Archie, Not that it all hasn't been horrible, but it's getting late and...
Oh, look, Pat, you can't leave. Now, I'm going to need you.
No, I'm sorry, Archie.
Look, if I tell you a secret, will you promise not to tell it to another human being in this joint?
Not even if I meet one.
Man, listen. Duffy has disappeared.
Who?
Duffy, the owner of this place. He's planning to kill himself.
The only decent thing for him to do.
Hey, Archie, when do we eat?
You hear that, Pat? We got to start the dinner. Now, these guys is all Duffy's loyal friends and bore him beautiful presents, you know. And if we don't give them the dinner, they'll all take their presents home. So what do you say, Pat? Will you help me?
What do you want me to do?
Well, I want you to stay for the dinner and read a poem that I wrote.
Poem that you wrote?
Yeah.
Okay, show me the wall.
It ain't wrote on no wall. It's wrote here on a hunk of paper. Here, look it over.
Say, Archie, when do we eat?
In a minute.
Pass me the sauce, please.
Yeah, here you are.
Let me have a hunk of bread.
Would you mind to pass me the butter?
Here.
Finnegan, that's no way to eat celery.
Sorry, Archie. Hey, this pig's knuckle looks beautiful.
Finnegan, let go of me hand.
Oh. Fellas, will you please watch your decorums here? Hey, Pat, you're not eating.
Want me to wind up in Forest Lawn?
Oh, come on. Try them pickled pig's feet. They're our specialty. Finnegan, pass Mr. O'Brien a pig's foot.
The pig's foot? What do you have, Mr. O'Brien? A left or a right?
We'll see if you can get him to walk by, and I'll decide.
Hey, Eddie, any word about Duffy yet?
No.
Oh, I can't. There's one more call I could make, but well, I guess I got it. Hello? City morgue? Look, have you got a rigor mortis there named Duffy? No, huh? Thanks. Well, he ain't there yet. Wonder where the guy can be. Well, we can't hold it up no longer. We better start the speeches. Okay, quiet, folks. Now, I want to welcome yous one and all to Duffy's 33rd anniversary party. The Duffys ain't here yet, pending their lack of arrival. However, they are represented by their lifelong daughter, Miss Duffy.
I thank you, dear people, in the name of Mom and Papa, whom are the parents, the daughter of whose I am proud to be the offspring. I thank you.
A lovely sentiment, Miss Duffy. Now, our next speaker will be Sir Heathcliff Batterswick.
I have never met Mr. Duffy personally, which reminds me of a story. It seems there were two Irishmen named Pat and Mike.
And now, our next speaker... Our next speaker will be that brave and fearless minion of the law, Officer Clancy.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've known Mr. Duffy for the last 40 years. And I can truthfully say that in this whole neighborhood, there is not one man that I've known longer, I thank you.
Clancy, that was really a beautiful tribute. And now a word from one of Duffy's loyalist employees, Eddie the Waiter.
Ladies and gentlemen, I worked for Mr. Duffy for a good many years. Now, he ain't the sort of man who throws money around or wastes it or even spends it. But underneath it all, he's got a good heart, I suppose. I thank you.
I hope Duffy's hearing all of this wherever he is. And now another one of Duffy's admirers, Mr. Clifton Finnegan.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to say that everything I am today, or ever was, or ever will be, I owe to my dear mother.
Yes. Yes, folks, and I'm sure that many more of Duffy's loyal friends would like to eulogize him also. Thousands of them. But I'm afraid that time permits, so... We will proceed to the big piece of resistance of the evening, a poem wrote by me and recited by Mr. Pat O'Brien.
Happy anniversary, Mr. and Mrs. Duffy. Yous have weathered weather both stormy and roughy. Through sunshine and foul, in sickness and rain, for 33 years, yous have stuck as a twain. You love your wife, Duffy. I've oft seen you hug her, although she might kiss you back with a Louisville slugger. She's still your whole world, although when you did mate her, she was not quite so lumpy around the equator. So we send you greetings from old Duffy's Tavern. Such marriages are only made up in Havern. Over each other for years did you drool. May it go on forever like a time capsule.
Very good. Very good. Oh, excuse me. Hello? Oh, hello, Mrs. Duffy. Huh? You found him? Where? Out on the window ledge. He's threatening to jump. Well, look, maybe I can talk him out of it. Reach the phone out to him. Fellas, it looks like he wasn't kidding. Hello? Hello, Duffy? Duffy, get in off of that ledge. But Duffy, don't talk like that. But Duffy, once you're dead, life ain't worth living. No, that's not true, Duffy. No, everybody loves you. Well, so what if a person's wife does slug him once in a while? She's got to have some fun in life, too. You're still gonna... Duffy, please. Look, wait just 1 minute. Hey, Pat, quick. Sing him an Irish song. Maybe it'll divert the guy.
Okay, give me the phone. I'll sing him McSorley's Twins.
Okay, Duffy, listen to this.
Now, Mrs. McSorley had fine pretty twins, two fat little divils they were. With the squallin' and bawlin' from mornin' till night, it would deafen you, I do declare. Beamy salt was a caution, the way they would scream, like the blast of a fisherman's horn. Says McSorley, not one blessed hour have I slept since them two little divils was born. With the dancin' and prancin' the whole blessed night, they could hardly stand up on their pins.
Ah, oh, what an elegant time at the christening we had of McSorley's two beautiful twins. And now the second verse, Duffy. Hello. Hello.
Give me that phone, quick. Hello? I thought so. He jumped. Well, fellas, we better get down there quick and condone Mrs. Duffy. Now, come on. Hey, wait a minute. I just thought of something.
What?
They live on the ground floor. He was just doing a whole dirty trick to scare his wife.
I know, but doesn't Mrs. Duffy know they live on the ground floor?
No, when they moved in, they had to heist it through the window like a piano. She didn't know what floor they lived on. Look, Pat, I'm sorry. The whole thing was a hoax act, you know, but it was very sweet to help us out, so if you want to blow now, we won't keep you here no longer.
Hmm? Oh, shut up, Archie. I'm beginning to like this crummy joint. Come on, boys, let's get on with the party. How about a little song?
Oh, okay, sure.
Okay.
The weather river, Shannon flows.
The Armed Forces Radio Service.
With Old Time Radio Essentials, this is Pete with Paul and Dave. That was an episode of Duffy's Tavern with guest star Pat O'Brien, originally broadcast March 16th, 1945 on the NBC Radio Network. Paul, this was your selection for this installment. What made you choose it?
Well, like I said, before we started the show with St. Paddy's Day coming up, I wanted to put a little bit more of an Irish flair into what we're going to be listening to. And so I was looking around, and it's like, Duffy's Tavern. That sounds like a perfect one. Because, I mean, we just did one recently. What was the other one we did?
Life with
the
Luigi?
The Husband and Wife.
Oh. The Husband and Wife?
Yeah.
Burns and Allen?
No, just recently. I can't think of the guy. Forget it. Anyhow, that one sounded kind of Irish. So I was like, okay, what else is Irish? So I started looking around. Oh, Duffy's Tavern. I didn't really want to find something that was, you know, like Jack Benny, and then in the middle of it just dropped an Irish episode. I wanted something with a little bit more, always a little on the Irish side. Kind of, you know, Life with Luigi was Italian, so this was like the Irish one. So that's why I decided to go with that. So I looked for one around the time frame of St. Paddy's Day, and then it had Pat O'Brien in it. So I'm like, that's a perfect one to use.
Excellent. Very good. Dave, what did you think of it?
Well, I think I've mentioned on the podcast once or twice before that I grew up with a kind of a fondness for these old-time radio comedies. And I remember having I almost said Life with Luigi. I had a Duffy's Tavern cassette collection that I think I got from Radio Spirits sometime in the mid-90s or the late 90s. And, you know, this I don't remember this episode being on there. So it was a nice kind of a blast from the past, but also something new because, as I mentioned, I don't think I'd ever heard this one before. And, you know, I've also mentioned before that I have, I guess, some reservations about some of the old sitcom structure, like the music breaks and stuff like that. But I've kind of come around to the opinion that they're sort of nice because, you know, you get tired of the rapid fire one liners and all that. And you can just kind of take a little snooze when the orchestra comes in or just enjoy the music. So as with the case with this, I think there was like a 4-minute music break pretty early on. And I thought that was kind of yeah, sometimes you're in the mood for it. You know, you want a little break from the jokes and then the, you know, you get Pat O'Brien.
It was good music.
It was good. Yeah. I don't mean to criticize the music at all. I just, sometimes I'm in the mood for laughter, you know, and I see the music as like an interruption. But this time around, I didn't mind it so much for whatever reason. So.
Well, the music was good, but it wasn't originally part of the show. I'm pretty sure that at the end they say this is the Armed Forces Radio Network. So they inserted the music to take the place of any commercials they may have had because they didn't announce it. And then just the music started and then they didn't back announce it like they do on the comedies. That was so-and-so playing such-and-such, you know, and Jack Benny and Fred Allen, they always play My Show Al Goodwin with blah, blah, blah. So I'm pretty sure that this was music that took the place of commercials just for the benefit of the Armed Forces Radio Service. But it was good. I agree. It was good. Now, I'm going to have to steer off the beaten path because I love Duffy's Tavern. And I think Archie's character is fantastic with his spoonerisms or malapropisms or whatever you want to call them. He'll say the wrong word and you got to laugh because the word he chose is this close to being the right one, but it's completely off track. And then Finnegan comes in, he talks, you know, Finnegan say Arch, you know, that guy. And Miss Duffy is so funny because she thinks she's beautiful and she's probably, you know, they treat her like she's annoying and homely and the boss's daughter and nobody wants her. So generally that is a fantastic combination, but this one, this particular episode, they relied so heavily on fat jokes that it really became uncomfortable for me. And as a former skinny person, I'm trans slender, you know. As a former slender person, I wasn't offended by it, but it just was pretty, you know, uncomfortable with however many they told at the very beginning when they're talking about Mrs. Duffy. And then they stopped, and it was funny again because they stopped, but then they came back at the end and said that they hoisted her up in a window and she didn't even know what floor she lived on. So.
Yeah.
To rely on something like that was just uncomfortable for me to listen to.
I kind of have to agree. Like at a certain point, it becomes a little, as the kids say these days, a little cringy, you know, yes. When it's just like one fat joke after another. It almost like borders on being hateful at a certain point. You know, I know these are just made up characters, but, you know, to the people listening to this, it might just, it's like, you know, man, like who's going to be the butt of the next joke, you know? Yeah. And it's like, there's a fine line between joking and just like the atmosphere becoming like an atmosphere of, you know, like I said, just kind of almost hatefulness. So I felt the same way with the fat jokes.
I figure it this way. Those guys had to write so many shows and all that sometimes the well goes dry and you go for the lowest hanging fruit.
Yeah.
And so maybe they couldn't think of squat.
Maybe, that was really maybe good so
that week. And they just get, oh, well, shit, your mother's so fat, you know, let's just go with that. Okay, so that's what was available, you know, that's all they could think of in the time frame.
Right.
So
right.
I'd like to try and give them some credit for, you know, not doing that on a regular basis, but it's like, oh, crap, we couldn't think of anything.
Now, to give them credit, I did think that the premise of the cake was so bad and so hard that Mrs. Duffy could have sat on it. That was pretty funny. Really,
yeah.
a good setup, because it wasn't really relying so much on her being fat as it was making fun of the cake. So it's a fine line, really.
Better make sure we put the candles out first.
Yeah.
Well, my favorite joke was actually probably one of the more dumb jokes, because you know me, I'm a big fan of just one-liners.
Yeah.
And puns. And there's a joke about oh really, O'Reilly.
Yeah. That's such an old. That's an old joke too. I mean, that was probably that probably had whiskers on it at the time they told it on the show.
Yeah, probably.
The thing I thought was, you were talking about cringeworthy, but you could almost feel him cringing. Was Pat O'Brien at the end when he had when he was reading the poem?
Yeah,
you can just hear him kind of like, why did I agree to this?
Now, what I like about Duffy's Tavern is that they brought in the big names. It was very big for celebrities on a weekly basis, which was great. And they'd come in and they'd take part in the comedy, and they may not be comedians. Ida Lupino, a very serious actress, for example, was a guest star one time, and she was so funny because she started talking exactly like Archie. The same sort of speech pattern. She adopted a New York accent, even though she's English, and then she started making the same kind of cracks as Archie did. But
I'm gonna look up this episode.
Yes, you should. It's very funny, and I just love that one. But and where am I going with this? So with Duffy's Tavern and the celebrities, you'd get people like and compared to Suspense. Suspense would bring in celebrities to play roles that may not play in other areas. Jack Benny played a serious character. Danny Kaye played a serious character.
Yeah.
Cary Grant would play characters different from his regular handsome leading man persona. So it was fun, and it's interesting to do it that way. And so it was with Duffy's Tavern. You might get a singer. There's one I listened to with Beverly Shea, the Park Avenue Hillbilly. And I first heard of her in the 80s. Well, she was a huge star, and she would sing these country songs and Western songs. This is before country Western was put together.
Back when there was two types of country music.
And she sang these. She had a beautiful voice, but she sang everything sort of in a hillbilly accent. And she was on there one time, and I think it was around for a Valentine's Day episode where Finnegan thought that Archie had forgotten to send him a Valentine's Day card, and then Duffy was mad at Finnegan because he hadn't gotten a Valentine's Day card from him. But it turns out they just had bought them, but they never mailed them out, and they each had them in their coat pockets or something like that. So, and then Beverly Shea, Dorothy Shea, rather, helped him figure that out. So it's just you never know who's going to be on the show, and you never know what's going to happen. But usually it's something funny. Pat O'Brien had kind of a tough guy persona in this one, and he was constantly insulting Archie. And when he had to read the poem, like Paul said, was he read the words that that Archie had written in the same sort of voice that Archie might do it. So it was funny. That part was very good.
Yeah, I admit I had to cheat a little bit because I did not recognize the name Pat O'Brien, and so. After listening to this, I had to look up his Wikipedia article, and just scrolling through the filmography section, I realized, oh, he's one of the cops from one of my favorite comedies, Some Like It Hot. And it seems like he tended to be portray priests and cops more than anything else.
Yeah, I would say he was pretty much stereotyped into one of those Irish characters.
Well,
not
his face. I like how they described him how Archie described him, how he's a big guy, big rugged kind of guy, you know, the kind of guy that the other guy gets the girl.
Yeah. It always seemed to be because he was in a movie with Clark Gable, and Clark Gable won the girl that he loved. So it was one of those cool things. And he was in one with, I think it was mentioned before we started the show, Jimmy Cagney. He was in Angels with Dirty Faces, and he played a priest.
Mm.
And Jimmy Cagney played the killer from the neighborhood who was awaiting execution. So
didn't those two, like, know, is it in the movie, didn't their characters, like, grow up with each other?
Yeah,
too?
They grew up together. One became a priest and one went to prison. So one went to a life of crime.
So politics.
Oh, yeah. No, Moira. It was Moira.
Do you guys know, speaking of, you know, the character of Archie, was there any kind of inspiration there for Archie Bunker? Or do you think maybe there's just, like, a prevailing kind of, you know, stereotype of, like, the dumb Irish guy, like, blue-collar Irish guy? Do you think there's any link there, or is that just
I would guess more of an influence as opposed to a direct tie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because Archie Bunker was very bigoted and opinionated, and Archie Goodwin for the show was just, you know, just a friendly guy who said the wrong thing.
Right, I mean, just superficially, just kind of like their mannerisms, and like you mentioned, Pete, like the
rough around the edges.
And like, you know, the mispronunciation of words, malapropism, spoonerism, that kind of thing. Like, I wonder if just superficially there was some kind of, you know, connection there with like writers sort of, you know, perhaps maybe paying homage to like an earlier character. Could be. I have no proof. I just wonder if you guys.
I never thought of that myself. It's worth a look, though.
Sure.
But, you know, the characters in All in the Family, Archie Bunker and Edith Bunker, those were adapted by Norman Lear from an English comedy with similar characters. So I forget the original name of the show that he developed.
Yeah, I've never seen it, but I was vaguely aware of it. So anyway, that's a digression.
That's okay. That's what we do.
That's what a conversation is. Just
we're famous for our digressions.
And we don't bother putting our turn signals on either when we change lanes in a conversation.
Well, I'm in Texas, and that never happens in real life anyway.
Yeah.
Oh, Texas, when they had that big pile up last month with this, it's like, I can understand that, because we came down to visit our son in Texas, and we drove from where he was at to Houston. Dear God, people in Texas just drive like it's the Autobahn, because Texas is so damn big and spread out, you have to drive like a bat out of hell to get anywhere.
Yeah. It takes nearly a day to get out of it if you're because I've driven to Illinois several times, and it takes about a day just to get out of the state. It's big, baby.
It's like you're driving. It's like if you're going someplace, you know, across the United States, you're like, oh, we're through this state. Oh, now we're through this state. Oh, we're in our final destination. We're in Texas. We're almost there. 2 days later, we're almost there. Yeah. What the hell did we stop?
And to bring it around to old time radio again, you could listen to Duffy's Tavern all the way across Texas. Several episodes.
turn signal.
And leave your turn signal on the whole way.
I'm that age.
I was doing it at 17, so it doesn't depend on the age. Whew. Okay. Anybody else have anything to mention about this episode, or anything about Duffy's Tavern in particular?
The only thing I've got to add is, before I ever listened to an episode of Duffy's Tavern, I've always been a fan of the Rat Pack. And I think it's actually Sinatra at the Sands, where he goes, "Where do you eat meat to eat?" And I'm like, thought that was kind of funny. I'm like, God, did he just do that because it was a rhyme or something, and he thought it was funny or something? And then only later on, when I started Duffy's Tavern, it's like, oh, now I get it. Now I know what he was referencing.
Yeah,
yeah. This was a massively popular show, right? So
yeah,
people at the time would have got that reference.
And people stole from radio comedy all the time. Bugs Bunny cartoons had all kinds of radio references and that sort of thing. So I'm not surprised. What I like about Duffy's Tavern is the consistency. They never change the beginning. The phone rings. Duffy's Tavern. Archie, the manager, speaking. Duffy ain't here. Oh, hello, Duffy. So Duffy never shows up.
Yeah.
His daughter's there. I think in this episode, the woman who played Miss Duffy was the same woman who played the original Gladys Kravitz on Bewitched.
Mm.
Oh, so if you listen, you know, you remember Mrs. Kravitz.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, very New York accent there. So
kind of Edith Bunker-ish sounding.
Yeah,
a little.
Oh, Abner. That's what I was trying to say. Abner. Her husband's name is Abner. Abner. So,
okay, let's vote. What are we voting on, dear listener? As a reminder, we're voting on A, whether this particular episode is a true representative installment of the overall series, and two, whether or not it is a standalone show that belongs in every radio aficionado's collection. And again, Paul, this was your selection, so you go first.
Fine. I'll vote. I liked it. Oh, okay. No, it was very good. I liked it. It was, you know, like you said, it almost seemed like they were picking at the low-hanging fruit a bit, this particular episode. But everything was still there for Duffy's Tavern. And it's just very enjoyable. Although I must say, is it just me, maybe because, like you said, Pete, being the Armed Forces version, that the music breaks seemed longer than they normally are, too.
It could be. Maybe they just didn't want to play a snippet of a song to cover the length of the commercial. They just decided, okay, we'll put a whole song in there. I have no idea. Because sometimes they would have a musical guest, and the musical guest would sing a song, but Pat O'Brien was not known for his, you know, warbling. So he wasn't a crooner. So
he wasn't up there with Crosby.
Right.
Okay, next.
Although they did sing Tura Lura Lura.
That's, they attempted to.
Dave.
I guess I tend to be a little stingy with the, personal collection criteria. So I would say maybe, you know, if you have a small bookshelf like me, don't put this in your personal collection. But yeah, this is absolutely representative of the series. You know, you've got a celebrity guest star. You've got good music, good jokes. This is a great Duffy's Tavern all around.
All right. Well, I'm going to veer away from you because although I did feel it was representative with all the factors there and everything, the cringe factor of the fat jokes make me say I don't think it belongs in every Radio Aficionados collection. So that's my opinion, and I'm sticking with it. All right, so nearly everybody agrees. I'm the only outcast, but that's okay. Friends,
vote.
Normally, this would bring us to the end of our episode, but we've been holding back some sad news, and I guess it's time to tell our listeners about that now. Once again, we must say goodbye to one of our co-hosts. Dave Feldman has been with us now since episode 11, which launched in February of last year. As we've told you before, he started his own podcast, Quietly Yours, after he joined us, and he wants more time to devote to that show. So, Dave, it's been a fun ride. You've brought your own special insight and experience with old-time radio to the discussion and helped raise the bar significantly. It won't be the same without you.
Well, thanks, guys. Being a guest on your show is my first foray into podcasting. So, it really kind of gave me the confidence to start another one with my friend Matt, something that focused on, you know, particular series. And so, you know, I just want to say, without getting all mushy, you know, thanks for thinking to have me on. I mean, it's been a lot of fun, and I hope you'll keep me in the Rolodex so you can bring me on in the future as an occasional guest.
Hear that, Paul? He loses his virginity in podcasting, and he wants to leave us.
I thought I heard a
gratitude for you.
Go ahead.
Yeah,
get
I know.
Teary-eyed. It's okay. We don't mind. We have that effect on people. They can't help but bond with
us. We like onions.
like ogres, we're layers.
As I told Pete, I just hope I'll be remembered more as a Shemp and less as a Curly Joe in the mythology of old-time radio essentials. I'd hate to think that I was held in low regard by any of the listeners.
Because when Jane left us, that was Curly who left, and now we brought in Dave, and he was Shemp. That was my analogy. Who's next? There's got to be either a Joe Besser or a Curly Joe to Rita. So the quality of our co-host is going down.
Don't tell that to whoever's coming on, for God's sake.
Oh, I will. Listen, I'm going to call him Curly Joe.
Hello, Curly Joe. How you doing?
All kidding aside, I'm sure whoever you guys bring in next is going to be great. And it's going to be, you guys have a great show here. So, there's no reason to get too teary-eyed. I see myself as kind of a long guest. But this is really your guys' show. And you guys are going to do great keeping it going. And I'm looking forward to hearing whatever you guys bring next, as long as
thanks very much.
As long as it isn't, that similar to that Lights Out, the infamous Lights Out episode that you guys did.
Oh, did you listen to that one?
Oh yeah, I've listened to all the back episodes.
Oh, okay.
And that one's your guys' conversation is a lot more enjoyable than the episode itself.
You know, I got to agree with them on that one.
Yeah.
But, oh yeah.
Someday I'll come back and I'm gonna try to bring something that's even worse than that, just for fun. So.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah. Well, I tell you, it was great having you here, Dave, because you did. You raised the bar when it came to doing the research and knowing the dates and stuff like that, and knowing who here was related over here and who did this. And I'm like, oh, you know, I probably should do a little more research before these instead of tap dancing through the minefield. So
I'm he actually started listening to the episode in advance, too, thanks to you, Dave. So
funny. Oh. Well, folks, this brings us to the end of episode 22 of Old Time Radio Essentials with Dave Feldman, Peter Lutz, and me, Paul RBC. Next time, the cycle comes back around to Pete. What will you have for us then, Pete?
Next time, it's more comedy, an episode of The Henry Morgan Show from 1947. Henry Morgan was an American comedian with a flair for the bizarre. That's all I'll say for now. We hope you'll join us for that next month on Old Time Radio Essentials. Dave, Paul, tell the masses what they need to know.
Old Time Radio Essentials is a production of 63 Audio. A proud member of the Mutual Audio Network. Subscribe to Apple or any other podcatcher you may use by searching under Mutual Audio Network and or Narada Radio Company.
Please follow us on the Twitter at Essentials Old. If you want to suggest a future episode, write us at f6.3@gmail.com. That's the letter F, the number 6, the word point, and the number 3@gmail.com. Put the word essentials in the subject line.
Remember, friends, we're always happy to hear from our listeners, so please do send us feedback and suggestions. And if you didn't catch our email when Paul spelled it out, rewind and listen again. Rewind. Or just look for it in the show notes.
Dave, we're going to miss you, kiddo. And we wish you much success with your podcast, Quietly Yours.
We sure do, Dave. Can you tell our listeners a little bit about it?
Yeah, it's a podcast that you can find out there on mostly on iTunes and Spotify are kind of the best venues for listening to it. And there's a Facebook group page called Quietly Yours Podcast. If you want to like join in a conversation with other fans of Willis Cooper's Quiet Please, you know, we have a lot of we just kind of nerd out on the history of the show and trivia about particular episodes and all that. And more to the point, it's a podcast I do with my buddy Matt Ellis. And we focus mostly on Quiet Please. And occasionally we'll bring in another spooky, eerie podcast and talk about that. And we kind of stick to the spooky stuff. But mostly we talk about Quiet Please. And we're just going through episode by episode and kind of talking about it in a wider context, you know, political and social, what was happening in old time radio. And so if you want to listen to our ramblings, you know, look it up, Quietly Yours Podcast.
Sounds great. And I know that you've got an episode coming up where you talk about the 1980s Canadian series called Nightfall.
Nightfall.
Yeah.
In the dream, you're falling. Yeah. The dream. The ever divisive Nightfall, which Matt and I love. Some people are kind of on the fence about it, and some people don't like it at all.
I think it's got some great episodes. Yeah, I really enjoy it. I enjoy it much better than the CBS Radio Mystery Theater.
I've gone on record many times saying I really do not like CBS Radio Mystery Theater. So, but that's a conversation for another day.
Not for our show though, because we're not ever going to touch on CBS Radio Mystery Theater. It's way outside the boundaries of our old time radio discussion.
Well, good.
Okay. So listen to Quietly Yours, folks. Listen to Quietly Yours with Dave and Matt.
Hey, that reminds me, speaking of podcasts, I want to ask Pete, when's the next episode of Adventures of the Federated Tech coming out?
You mean my series based on the Continental Op stories by Dashiell Hammett? I've been informed by my producer, Daniel French, that the fourth installment, called The Black Hat That Wasn't There, is going into production this week and will be released shortly after. I'm happy to say that you've been active in this series, Paul, and have played several roles so far.
Tort nothing. and I understand Dave made his acting debut in a recent episode of The Cellar.
He sure did. You can hear him as one of the townspeople in The Woman at Loon Point. I think you did a nice job, Dave, and I hope you know you're always welcome back here at Old Time Radio Essentials.
Well, you know, like I said, keep me in the Rolodex, send me a telegram when you need someone to come on, and, you know, my people will get in touch with your people.
Excellent. Fantastic. And our people can have lunch. Okay, it's time to wrap
our
things up.
Can stab you and put in the stomach with a hole with the blood coming out. Sorry.
I put my hand over your mouth so you cannot say nothing. Yes.
Okay, it's time to wrap things up. That's it for now, everybody. Join us next time for another fun installment of Old Time Radio Essentials. Bye-bye for now, and happy St. Patrick's Day. When Irish eyes are smiling, that's a Chinese lullaby.
Something like that.
Good night, everybody.
Wow.
Wait a minute.
And now, friends, adjust your radio dials to the proper... Wow, that sucked.
Try it again.
Do that over, because I tried slowing it down and deepening it up, and I just slid right into Liverpool.
63 Audio.
This is Mutual.
You're tuned into Monday Matinee on the Mutual Audio Network. Tomorrow is All Things Horror on Tuesday Terrors. Subscribe to the full Mutual Audio Network feed for every day, or find Tuesday Terrors in your favorite podcast players.
The Mutual Audio Network. Listening and imagining together.